Hey, good morning or good evening. How's everyone doing? Quantitative disease, women, human, fat vegan, Miss Petite, morning to everyone. So let me try and get my notes back in order here. Got a lot going on. How's everyone doing? Okay. Hey guys, as always, could you give me some feedback on the audio levels? Just want to make sure they're okay for you guys. Full name, human, built for tough, low blood pressure. That's a good problem, I think. I'm always high strung, so it's good to have some low blood every now and then. Good name, like that. Tony, I invented the reversible straw. All right. Habar, how you doing? Don Jackson. Okay. QD, thank you. Quantitative disease. Thank you. Hope I have a good week also. Hope all of you have a good week. Okay, sounds okay. Thank you. Appreciate that. See, I got quite a bit going on, and I'm just looking at my notes here, and I am bound to get lost in some of these notes, so we'll just try and get through this together. So let me gather up some notes, and then we'll go ahead and get started with this shortly. Yes, the like button, please. That really helps us out. Appreciate it. Hello again, everyone. Welcome to another edition of Silver Bullion Television, SBTV. I'm your host, Patrick Vieira, and this is our live stream where things tend to go wrong from time to time. So please bear with me, and hopefully things will kind of stay in order. Thank you all for being here again. Built for Tough, Brian Rivera, Miss Petite, Michael B., Pudenda Johnson, Fat Vegan again. Thank you all for being here, wherever you might be, whether you're in Europe, Asia, whether you're in the States, maybe nighttime where you're at, or maybe early morning where you're at. So again, thank you for being here. Really do appreciate it. A lot going on. But as always, if you are new to this channel or you have not already done so, please do subscribe, click on that bell to be notified on updates, and give us a thumbs up. We really do appreciate your support. Really do. And we thank you guys for it. You can always find us on social media. We're on silverbullion.com.sg. That is our website. We are a silver bullion dealer over in Singapore. And I think most of you know that I do work for Silver Bullion. So just to keep some clarity on that, transparency on that. Facebook, Silver Bullion SG. Twitter, Silver Bullion PL. The audio versions, bit.ly, SBTV iTunes, SBTV Spotify. And guys, please join this crisis tracker group. I mean, we go through it every day. We put out information every day, maybe 2, 3, 4 articles. Super important. I mean, whether it's financial news, economic news, news about gold and silver, it's a good way to kind of stay abreast of things. And do join it if at all possible. Get the Telegram app on your phone. You even can put it on your desktop. And t.me/crisis tracker. Go ahead and put that in and join the group, and then we'll always be able to have some pretty good news articles to you guys. So I do hope that you will join that crisis tracker group. Super important. I'm going to figure out how to bring it up and so you guys can see what's going on with it. But for now, I get kind of glitchy trying to bring it into the software program. So one day I'll figure it out for you guys. I am the Buddha. Okay. I'll be happy if we make it out of 2020 without sun burning out. Okay, those are some pretty profound words. So, I hope we do as well. I hope that sun never does go out. I mean, even though it seems like it's raining every day, we're getting some, you know, less than positive news every day. There's still a lot of good things to look forward to. Quite a bit of good things to look forward to. So stay the course. Let's just stay the course. We'll get through it. We will get through it. Thomas Toops, I subscribed and got a free toaster. I didn't get one. I subscribed. How'd you get the free toaster? Nah, just kidding. Thomas, always thank you for your support. Appreciate it. And always good, that sense of humor. Good stuff. So let's see what else is out here. John Cantrell, welcome aboard. Hugh Mann, I don't think I've seen you before. So again, welcome aboard. Daryl Wilson, aloha from Hawaii. Aloha, Daryl. Hope everything's going well there. You should be in the afternoon there. Okay, mid-afternoon. So getting close to evening. So I will wish you aloha ahi ahi, coming close to the evening. Again, Fat Vegan, Michael B. So again, glad you all could be here. Coming up, our next guest, we're going to have Chris Vermeulen later this week. Chris is the founder of Technical Traders, pretty interesting guy. He's going to be a first-time guest, and again, as mentioned, he is the founder of Technical Traders, which is a leading innovator in technical analysis systems and trading strategies since 2001. The assets that they cover include stocks, bonds, precious metals, oil, and natural gas. And Chris, as mentioned, he always has an interesting take on things, which goes well for the interesting times that we are in. So again, don't miss this one. Be sure to subscribe and hit the bell. I think Chris and I will have a pretty good conversation going on. So do subscribe and hit the bell. So anyway, moving on, let me take a look at some more of these. Kaui, Kaneokoa. God bless also. Take care of yourself over there. I think you guys are doing pretty good managing things there. So let's just hope all of us can manage things. I guess we're being fed a lot of news again. Second wave, this, that. You know, first things first, you know, just always be safe. We'll find out, sure enough, whether what's going on with this whole thing. But main thing first, you know, be safe. And on the other side of it, really know what's going on, especially with the economy. That's, you know, equally as important, because, you know, a lot of people are saying we're starting to see that transfer happen already. And you've probably heard for quite a while, the wealth transfer. So, you know, do what you need to do. And this is where we try to offer opinions to help along the way during this transfer, or understanding it at least. You know, if it's not the time right now, at least it's good to understand what's coming ahead. And this is what we try to do. Elbow Sanchez, how you doing? Jacob Dahl, again, Tony Brian Rivera. So good to see you all. Good to see you all. Glad that you folks are here. So first things first, I'm going to go ahead and take a look at the gold price and see where we're at this morning here in Asia. So again, this is our website, silverbullion.com.sg. Let me refresh this. It's been open for a while. And where are we at? US dollar, we're seeing silver getting back into the 18 range. Which is good. Let's see if it can hold it. That'll be another story. Gold, 1773. It's been trying to stick around at 1750. It's been trying. It goes down, it comes up, it goes down. Whatever happens, you know, and we saw last week a beat down of sorts take place, but both metals showing some resiliency. I would say probably people like you and me who are seeing that opportunity to pick up physical along the way. So again, silver hanging on to that 18 range, or getting back up to it, I should say, and gold 1773. I think that's important, where gold needs to hang on to 1750, and it needs to really stick at around 1775 and not get too much below that 1750. If it can do that, I think we're going to see a start to push a push anyway with the metals, and I think we'll see silver start slingshot a bit. So hang on there. We'll see what happens. Again, investor kit, this is free. Do download it. A lot of good info. And again, sign up for the storage accounts. These are free. You never know. I mean, if you have, you know, some reservations about what's going on in the world, and you're not sure if hanging on to to the your metal with you in your home country, if you feel your home country may be headed more towards a bit of chaos than stability, then you may want to consider at least understanding the benefits of storage. So something to keep in mind. And of course, peer-to-peer, this is something when you do store with us, you are allowed or able, I should say, to use your gold and silver as collateral to get a secured low interest loan and go ahead and use that money for whatever you need to use it for. It's a good program. Guys have been doing it for years, and you know it's a safe program. Hang on, let me get back here. Ratio 98.4, so it's under 100. That's a good thing. Trying to stay in that 90 range, below 100 range. It's difficult for silver right now, but again, we're going to see what happens as time goes by. So, you know, we did see that little bit of a beat down last week, but it's come back up. It's come back up. So that's a good thing. That's a good thing. So silver hanging on there. And again, these are some of the products that we sell. This one, we see a lot of people move into these 1,000-ounce bars. It's a big boy, that's for sure. But it also gives you probably the best savings as far as being able to buy silver close to spot prices. So these are some of the products, gold and silver. And checking the Twitter feed, bookmarks anyway, let me go back up to the top. Twitter's been pretty interesting this week. Jeff Gibbs sending a message to Luke Groman. Brookshire Brothers, due to limited allocations of coins from the Federal Reserve, all customers are encouraged to use any form of payment other than cash. You know, this is one of the signs of inflation, hyperinflation, so to speak, is when you have people moving away from the currency, their own home currency. It is a sign. I'm not saying this is it, but this is also a sign leading or inflation to hyperinflation, where people move away again from their home currency. So I found that one pretty interesting, and we're gonna get into that. Fed goes burr. This is a bit heartbreaking when you see this. Peak prosperity, Chris Martinson. Approximately $2 million worth of vehicles lined up for $5,000 of food. Crazy times for sure. So I guess, you know, I don't know what city this was in, but I guess a lot of people need relief right now. And, you know, so I guess he's making a point about, you know, we can get cars and things like that, but, you know, food, you know, the more important things, we got to be able to get those. So, Chris Martinson there. This one. Or Boris Capital, the expectation of future purchasing power. You know, when I first saw this one, kind of made me think back to when I was a kid. And I think some of you folks may remember this.
Hey, you ready to play a little game? Okay, good. Here we go. Three of these kids belong together. Three of these kids are kind of the same. But yeah. One of these kids is doing
one is very different
thing.
From the other three,
now
huh?
It's time to play our game. It's time to play our game. Can you tell which kid is doing his own thing?
Yeah, three of those are definitely different from the other one. That's for sure. So anyway, yeah, I just wanted to get in a few giggles with you guys before we get into the more serious stuff. Let me take a look at some of your comments real quick before we move on. Let me go back up here. Sorry about that. Okay, sorry, let me go through this. Appliance analysis. Yeah, that was one that I wanted to take a look at. Silver will fly if Mexico locks down the mines again. Watch for that. That is true. We... First time around when there were the lockdowns going on, we saw air travel slow down, and the movement of bullion just wasn't happening. And we saw that big difference in spreads over at Comex. It was quite a big deal. This time around, I think, you know, if we're going to see mines, as mentioned here, locked down, could very well see the same thing again. I mean, not just if air travel comes to a halt, but also the supply of silver and gold comes to a halt. So, you know, this is something, knowing that it's a very real possibility, I personally would not be waiting to buy the dips. I would just be trying to get silver and gold in my hand as quickly as I could, reach a point to where I'm comfortable, and then move on. You know, this not, it's not meant to panic anyone or anything like that. It's just to realize, you know, the bug has shown us one thing. There are masses of people out there, and a lot of them do have money, and they will gobble up things really quick, and that can leave you and I, you know, waiting and hoping that it comes back online, wondering when it comes back online. So thing is, if you can get it, go ahead and get it. So that was a good comment. That was something that I wanted to pop in and bring up. Getting back to Twitter, Ben Hunt, the four largest economies in the world in order of size are the U.S., the EU, China, and Japan. The EU, Japan, and China have figured out a way to control the bug without wrecking their economies. U.S. has not. This is a turning point in the global balance of power. Now, again, the bubbles were already there. You know, it was just floating around, waiting to run into pins to be pricked. There were many, many pins surrounding these bubbles, and this is just the one that the bubbles happened to run into, and we see the Fed scrambling. Economies, I think, you know, despite the good news that we were hearing before the bug, I think a lot of us realized, you know, it was, you know, kind of teetering. And so, you know, the bubble or the bug coming along, you know, it was bound to happen. Something was going to pop it or prick it, and we see the Fed trying to blow it up again. Max Keiser, CLO is the CDO of 2020. You guys follow the live stream, you know that we've brought this up time and time and time again, where these collateralized loan obligations of today, they are the CDOs back in 2007, 2008. A lot of guys felt that CLO was safe. Obviously not. We see the Fed scrambling, trying to keep up a lot of companies going into buying corporate bonds. So, I mean, this is something that we've been talking about for quite a while. So Max Keiser, he's on it as well. And then we have this one from former pen name Kuz Johnson, where he says, or he brings out this article, where a $10 trillion Fed balance sheet is coming. The enormous figure deserves attention, but for now, the risks seem to be manageable. So I just want to take a quick peek at this article here, if I can get it up. Hang on. Okay, let me go ahead and share this one. A $10 trillion Fed balance sheet is coming. This is from Bloomberg. The Federal Reserve's balance sheet is exploding, growing by about $3 trillion since mid-March. And we've seen it. It's just phenomenal what's going on with it. And now totally more than $7 trillion. It could conceivably exceed $10 trillion by year end. And we've even talked about that as well. As the central bank buys corporate bonds, municipal securities, and makes loans to medium-sized businesses, while purchasing $80 billion of treasuries and $40 billion of agency mortgage-backed securities, or MBS. This would more than double the peak that the Fed's balance sheet reached in the 2008-2009 financial crisis. So again, that's pretty important, because one of the things, again, that leads up to inflation, hyperinflation type scenario is just the printing of money, debt over debt over debt over debt. And again, this is one reason why we're just going to take a look at it. David Rosenberg, he read this article in the New York Times. Incredible. Got some advice for Steve Mnuchin. Check the death records before sending out any more stimulus checks. So this was, I'm not even sure if this is laughable. I mean, I find this pretty serious, where $1.4 billion in stimulus funds were sent to people already deceased. It kind of makes you wonder, does the Fed really, I mean, of course they have that much money, they can print the money, but again, if they're just throwing money all over the place, not even really checking to find out things, you are going to get people who are going to say, why should I even pay my taxes? Just go ahead and print it. The reason people have to pay taxes is because when the Treasury sells bonds or whatever it may be to fund programs, again, the Fed can only loan money. It has to have some form of collateral. It has to have some form of collateral, and taxes are one of those forms of collateral. So that is the reason why we have to pay taxes, because the Fed tells government, okay, I'll loan you the money. How are you going to pay me back? Fed is going to say, well, we'll pay you back, or the government will say, we'll pay you back through taxes. So again, this is why this is going to be a very, very sticky topic to talk about, because the Fed is giving everybody relief. Why not tell people they don't need to pay taxes? And if that ever went through, you can bet the dollar as a reserve currency will be history overnight. That would be something with certainty. Simon Mikhailovich, either the banks have achieved 100% success rate at managing their risks, or they have achieved 100% success rate at managing their regulators. So bank stocks soar after FDIC relaxes key Volcker rule restrictions. This is coming from an article from CNN. Maybe I'll just go ahead and play this clip. I mean, as you can see, it's 3 minutes, but I'll play it so we can get a better understanding of what's going on here.
The market's taking a big hit overnight following the fall of U.S. investment giant Lehman Brothers.
Bad bets on the housing market sunk giants of Wall Street.
This is absolutely stunning. Wall Street has seen very, very few days like this.
In response, Congress and President Obama signed the most significant financial reform act of the century, the Dodd-Frank Act. It touches on everything from ensuring banks have capital to how your credit card bills look to building entirely new regulatory bodies.
It is no secret to this group that consumers need.
Okay, you know, this is kind of choppy. I'll just run through the article if I can. The Volcker Rule, part of the broader Dodd-Frank bill enacted in 2010. Following the meltdown of the big banks in 2008, sought to crack down on risky behavior by Wall Street firms. And we spoke about this, where there were regulations put in place, but they will find ways to get around these regulations. And this bill was named after former Federal Reserve Chair Paul Volcker, passed away last year. Many banks and brokerages were using their company's own money. Oops, hang on. Using their company's own money to invest in derivatives such as mortgage-backed securities and other complex financial instruments. The eventual collapse of the subprime mortgage market, loans to borrowers with poor credit history, created a ripple effect that led to the collapse of Bear Stearns, Lehman Brothers, Washington Mutual, and other countless firms. Giant banks wound up needing to receive hundreds of billions of dollars in federal bailout money to stop the bleeding. So there was this bill, the Dodd-Frank bill, which was enacted. And the regulator said that the changes will allow banks to allocate resources to a more diverse array of long-term investments in a broader range of geographical areas, industries, and sectors that they may be able to access directly. So this change, what we saw was shares of Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, Chase, Morgan Stanley, Bank of America, Citigroup, and such, all went up. So the new rules are the latest example of how regulators in the Trump administration are undoing much of the Obama-era rules put into place to curb bad behavior by big banks. FDIC, Fed, and other agencies had already neutered the part of the Volcker Rule that restricted so-called proprietary trading by banks, the practice of investing with the firm's own funds instead of bets for clients. So what we saw was we moved off the Volcker Rule, or we're starting to water it down. The protections that were in place, not so much there anymore. They're being watered down. All right, so let me get back to Twitter here. And some of you guys mentioned this. I saw it. The collapse of the U.S. shale industry has begun. Within 10 years, 75% of U.S. shale oil production will be lost. And, you know, some of them, as you guys mentioned, were Chesapeake. You guys are on it, definitely on it. A few more things. All fiat currencies sink, just at different rates. And this is the thing. When these currencies sink, your purchasing power starts to lessen. And as your purchasing power starts to go down, that's when you start to see a bit of inflation. I mean, there are other factors, but one of them definitely is when you start to lose your purchasing power. This was when Jerome Powell wasn't wearing lavender ties, when he first was getting into the position of head of Fed, and he was being given advice by successful in quotations, Fed chairmen.
And I wonder what kind of advice you've given Chairman Powell about the withering criticism that you might get from the public, Congress, business, the president.
Well, I kept on my desk a quotation from Abraham Lincoln to the effect that if you're right, it won't matter what they say. If you're wrong, it won't matter what they say. So the best thing to do is to make what you believe is the right call.
Chair Yellen, what advice did you give to Chairman Powell?
We worked together closely, and I knew that he knew everything that one needs to be a successful chair, to be inclusive in decision making, to bring many voices to the table, to listen carefully.
Being in this role is a very humbling thing, and yeah, I think you learn to listen to other people's perspectives pretty well.
And I wonder what kind of advice you've given Chairman Powell.
Okay. So that one was kind of strange. I mean, Bernanke is saying one thing and then Yellen is laughing, and I know maybe it doesn't mean much, but you know, considering everything that's going on, you know, it's, I don't know, I just found it a bit distasteful. They are definitely disconnected from the rest of us, that's for sure. TF Metals, 3 months ago, QE was announced. COMEX Gold was 1488. It's now 1785, well, 1778, around there, as we just saw. That's a gain of 20%. Another 20% over the next 90 days would take the price to 2142. That would work. So, Turd Ferguson, he's on it. As always, Jim Bianco, just call it off altogether. He's referring to Mnuchin looking at delaying the tax filing deadline to September 15th. No decision yet. Again, this is huge. It's going to be politicized for sure. Make no mistake about that. Simon Mikhailovich, again, whatever lies ahead, once it starts happening, it'll be faster than one can react. It's time to prepare is now. And this is in reference to Stephen Roach, a Yale University senior fellow and former Morgan Stanley guy in Asia, where he tells Market Watch that U.S. dollar, or the decline of the U.S. dollar, could happen at warp speed. Going back to this article, if they start to push tax collection back, or if they take it off altogether, that will definitely push this into play, where the decline of the U.S. dollar would happen. And it's strange because I think you're going to get the masses who are actually going to like this. But then the rest of the world, absolutely, what choice do you have but to really start scratching your head and possibly turning away from the dollar. So, you know, I think we're going to see more division, sad to say. But nothing there unifying people right now. Tavi Costa. Silver outperforming gold, silver miners outperforming gold miners, juniors outperforming seniors, exactly how a bull market for precious metals should look. Interesting thing with his chart here, I just wanted to bring this up real quick. You look at the beatdown it had in March, right? I mean, we went pretty low. Silver went pretty low in March. And you look how it's come back up, and then it's come back up again. And I mean, it's taken its hits along the way. But if you look at this, March, April, May, you know, a couple months, actually even 1 month, and then it goes up again, comes down a bit, goes back up again. I mean, looking at this chart here, by the time it reaches August, September, if it stays true, once it gets to around this area here, you're probably looking at $19.50, $20 already by that time, August, September. So, and I found this chart interesting. If it continues to happen before the election in November, for U.S. anyway, or end of summer, beginning of fall, you could very well be looking at, you know, $19-$20 an ounce for silver if this continues. So it's a pretty interesting chart by Tavi. So I guess that is one positive thing out there. So Tavi Costa, Thank you. Thank you for that one. Appreciate it. Okay. Oh, let me get through these comments. I know you guys have been going at it here. Let me see. It's enslavement of Western civilization. It's a good point on taxes. If people can't pay by end of September, will they go to prison? Well, I don't, that's a great question. I mean, I don't think the government is even, that's a good question. Hard for me to answer on that, but I think politically, geopolitically, government has to save face by at least telling the world, you know, we're taking in taxes or things like that. I don't think they're going to, it's difficult if they say, you know, 20% of people had paid taxes, 80% did not pay their taxes yet. I mean, can you imagine if they came out and said that, you know, the implications that would follow there and after. This is going to be politicized without a doubt. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens with taxes as time goes on. I'm curious to see. Okay, so what else is out there? Rolf Steiner, got to add 20% minimum on for physical silver right now. I tell you what, it's not a bad idea to be picking up silver. I mean, you know, looking at Tavi's chart, seeing news about, you know, this so-called second wave thing going down and if it's going to affect miners. And we already know how it affects airlines and transportation. So, again, I would say if you can get it, go ahead and get it. It's not financial advice, professional or otherwise. I'm just, you know, giving my opinion or things that I would do. I'm just sharing that with you folks there. So, you know, don't interpret it as financial advice. I'm just saying, look at things around you. And if you feel something's not right, then only you can make that change. Because if you don't make the change, someone else is going to make that change for you. If there's anything in life that we all should know, is if we know something and we don't change it, someone else will change it for us without question. So, again, great comments. Appreciate that. Okay, just going through these comments again. So, let me get here. So, you know, with everything going on, all the Fed intervention, can't help but to think people are getting fed up, you know. We see this, you know, with what's going on. And it's not just in the U.S. It's a global thing right now. People are getting pretty upset with their governments and things like that. People are losing confidence in governments all over the world. And I mean, the reality, a lot of us are one hardship away from losing confidence, even in the monetary system that we have today. And with all the money, the fiat sloshing around the world and knowing central banks will not let deflation settle in at all costs. They're not going to let deflation settle in. The alternatives are what are we looking at? Stagflation, inflation, hyperinflation. So these are the things that we're looking at right now. But of these three, hyperinflation may have the most dire of consequences. So this being 2020, what I wanted to do was go ahead and take a look at 20 steps to hyperinflation. So let me pull this up. Let me share that screen with you guys. So this is from monkey.com, the steps to hyperinflation. So this is what we'll spend some time on. Government spending gets out of control to where deficit is 40% or more of spending and the debt is over 80% of GNP. Instead of GNP, what I was looking at was GDP. So it's a little bit of a different metric, but the thing with GDP is once you're over 90%, you're in trouble. Your economy is not gonna, it's not really gonna grow once you reach over 90%. And so here we are today. We are at 107% total public debt as a percentage of gross domestic product. So we're already there. I mean, that's one of the things. So getting back to hyperinflation, that was step one. We're pretty much there. Central bank starts buying up government debt with newly made money. Okay, so this is step two. So I will bring this one up for you. Hang on, let me get it up. Okay, step two. Investors should ask who will buy all of this new U.S. government debt. Okay, so this is from FT.com, Financial Times. I couldn't pull up the website, so luckily I made a copy of it here. But once upon a time, a whole 2 months ago, Jim Cramer, the hyperactive American television host, was famous for his love of free markets and equities. Now he has a new focus, persuading Donald Trump's White House to issue war bonds to fund the fight against the bug. It's time for the 30-year trillion dollars. He tweeted, this was back in April, so this is about, you know, a couple months ago, declaring that domestic investors want this piece of paper. We want to win this war. And Jim Cramer, he's in his own world, gotta say. Will Trump listen? It's unclear. Larry Kudlow, Cramer's former colleague at CNBC, who is now chief White House economic advisor, says he is all for war bonds as a long-term investment. And the terms they use, credible. However, Steve Mnuchin says, or he is less persuaded. No wonder, with 30-year treasuries commanding a yield of just 1.4%, there is little immediate logic for the government to sell bonds that would cost the governments more. Yeah, 1.4%. I mean, wow. In any case, Mr. Mnuchin needs households to spend money on goods and experiences, not bonds with or when the bug ends. And so this gets back to velocity of money, you know. They want us to spend. They are going to find ways to make us spend. Investors should take note of this for three reasons. Firstly, government debt levels are exploding in a manner which will soon shine a spotlight on who buys the treasuries. Again, this is a big deal here. Let me go down a bit. Hang on. Investors ponder the future. They should read a remarkable letter the Wall Street banks wrote to the Treasury last year, well before the bug, which warned of an increased need for U.S. debt to be financed domestically. Again, you and me, they want us to buy. Since the proportion of foreign purchases of U.S. Treasuries was falling. Okay, so who's buying the bonds? It's not foreign purchases. They've stopped. Who's buying the bonds? They want us to buy it. And of course, we know the Fed is buying it. So the banks suggested then that U.S. households could be natural future buyers since their holdings were relatively low. So getting back to that one there. Oh, hang on. Sorry about that. So getting back to that one there. Central bank starts buying up government debt with newly made money. We've seen that one, capital flight. Okay. So the thing with this one, it is the government that is basically buying up the bonds. Foreigners are not buying bonds the way that they used to. So when you ask that question, or when you see this step to hyperinflation, central banks start buying up government debt with newly made money. We're seeing that. And this also answers step four, bond sales fail. So central banks are buying it on one end. They want us to buy it domestically on one end. And on the other end, foreign sales or foreign holdings, it's just not there as much as it once was. So two and four, we're pretty much there already. So step one, step two, step four, we're there as far as steps to hyperinflation. Step three, there is capital flight out of that currency. Well, it's not happening yet in masses, but however, you do not want to wait for the masses. I mean, when the masses do it, capital controls surely will be put in place. And we see what happens in countries like Argentina, right? I mean, we can say perhaps even before capital controls come into play, capital flight happens. People see it, people sniff it out, they start moving their money. And then this is when capital controls start to eke in. A flight to capital safety, the safe haven assets like gold and silver should have already taken off. You don't want to wait for masses to, you know, you need to move before the masses. And if you can see it already, do what you need to do. Don't wait for everybody else to do it, because it may just be a little bit too late by that time. So do what you need to do. I mean, we're seeing what's happening already. So again, So steps 1, 2, 3, and 4, we're already there. Okay, so let's move on to step 5. Step 5 on this. Okay, investors move into shorter term bonds as the years pass and it becomes clear that the deficit is not going back down. Okay, short term bonds. This is from Investopedia. I'll just read this section here. Why do they move into short term bonds? Well, there's a greater probability that interest rates will rise. In an inflationary environment, interest rates will rise and thus negatively affect a bond market or a bond's price within a longer time period than within a shorter period. So this is why they move into short-term bonds, less risk. If you hang on to it for a longer period of time, inflation sets in, you're going to see that interest rate rise, you're going to lose money. So as a result, investors who buy long-term bonds but then attempt to sell them before maturity may be faced with a deeply discounted market price when they want to sell their bonds. In other words, they're going to lose money on it when that interest rate rises to combat inflation. With the short-term bonds, the risk is not as significant because interest rates are less likely to substantially change in the short term. Short-term bonds are also easier to hold until maturity, thereby alleviating an investor's concern about the effect of interest rate-driven changes in the bond prices. Okay, so again, with the risk of inflation, much less hyperinflation, interest rates would have to go up to control inflation. And with bonds, when interest rates go up, as I mentioned, interest rates go up, bond prices go down. And with fears of inflation, you would be more inclined to get short-term bond rather than a long-term bond. So that's why people will move over into short-term bonds. So moving on to the next. So investors move into short-term bonds. That's the reason why. Number 6, government is forced to print more and more money. As a result, more and more bonds coming due sooner to cover their budget. But this part here, government is forced to print more and more money. We just need to take a look at the M2 money stock from the Fed. Go all the way to the end, and they even have a gray, you see this gray bar here now? Gray bars signal recessions. I don't know if I've heard the Fed actually say recession, but it's on their chart. We are officially, or the Fed has officially seen this as a recession. So there it is. And when you look at the money supply, you can see it just shoot up here. Kind of spooky to think where this thing is going to go. That's why people are speculating a $10 trillion balance sheet possibly by the end of the year. So we can see all along here, you know, it's relatively flat and, you know, just gradual incline, gradually. But this one here, it is concerning, guys. I mean, we gotta really understand that they are just printing money and throwing money all over the place. And again, this is another step or another nail to inflation, possibly even hyperinflation. So money's all over the place. They want us to spend. What they do is, or what they're trying to do is get us to spend. So, you know, that's that part there with the money stock. So going back to it, number 7, velocity of money picks up. And this is something that we haven't really had yet, the velocity of money. Even when we take a look at that chart, we're seeing it since the last crisis, 27, 28. It's been downhill. And with this, you've had QE1, QE2, QE3. I mean, money, again, thrown all over the place. And they could not get the velocity of money going. They couldn't get that mythical 2% inflation target. So, you know, Fed, it's not, you're not going to get velocity of money by throwing money all over the place, okay? You're trying to fight off deflation. They do not want deflation to happen. They're throwing money all over the place, but still, it's not happening. You can see here, this is the velocity of M2 money stock. The velocity is just not happening. So on one side, one chart, we have printing of money going up, way up. And on the other chart, we're seeing, but nobody's really using it. Why is that so? I mean, is it going into the right hands? The money you're giving to the people, is it enough for them to comfortably spend and feel confident that that things are okay. That's a different story entirely altogether. And, you know, some of these things that will push the velocity of money again, negative interest rates. I mean, can you imagine if you have savings in the bank and it's negative rates? I mean, you're going to lose money if it's in the bank, right? I mean, in simplistic terms. So that would force you to spend. You know, you'd realize that each day you hang on to your cash, it's going to be worth less and less. So negative interest rates are one thing. Fed is trying to avoid that, but that is one thing that could push the velocity of money, get you and me to spend. Higher government relief packages. Well, if they gave everyone, you know, through PPP or whatever it may be, if they gave people more money than the 1,200 stimulus checks or the 600, whatever it is now, that might incline people to spend. But do they want to do that? We'll have to see what happens. I mean, there have been calls on the Hill where they want to give people more of relief packages. So that could be one thing. Another thing is the duration of relief packages. If you guys knew that for 2 years you were going to get a certain amount of money and you don't have to worry about it, about things, you knew you were going to get X amount for 2 years, you would spend money. You would definitely want to spend, and that would kickstart velocity of money. But if you know you're only getting it for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, you're going to hang on to it. You know, you probably wouldn't hang on to it. So that's not going to start velocity of money unless you tell people for the next year or two, you're going to get this check every month. That might start velocity of money and probably start inflation as well. Lengthy government infrastructure projects, we talked about that last week, that would kickstart velocity of money. Well, again, it would kickstart velocity of money. If guys knew they had jobs for the next 5, 10, 15 years and the paychecks were pretty much guaranteed because it were federal projects, they're going to spend. They're going to feel confident. Wealth effect is going to go on. You know, as we talked about last week, they may be inclined to buy homes. They're going to spend. They are going to spend. So these are just some things that the Fed could go ahead and do to kickstart that velocity of money. Okay, so going back to our little 20 things here, we'll get through it. We'll get through it. Okay, so government is forced to print more and more. 7, velocity of money. Number 8, many people start using foreign currencies or gold as a store of value when they realize that the local currency is not a good store of value, even though government may forbid it. Okay, so that's pretty interesting because in masses, we're not there yet. However, as I pointed out over the last 3 months or so, have been incredible as far as sales of gold and silver. We're also seeing cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin. I mean, even they take a hit, but they recover. So as far as number 8, when it says many people start using foreign currencies or gold as a store of value, we're already seeing that as well. So, I mean, you know, quite a bit of these steps to inflation, hyperinflation, we're already seeing. It's already here without question. And, you know, with that, you know, I think it's a fair statement to say that both old money being gold and silver and new money being cryptocurrencies are seen as either a safe haven or possible currency as an alternative to fiat. This is true, especially if inflation or hyperinflation sets in and you already want to be in that store of value. Again, you don't really want to wait for the masses to move. This is something you need to take care of on your own. Okay, so that was number 8. Number 9, a black market starts in currency exchange. So black market starts in currency exchange. I kind of see this a little bit different, where maybe not a black market, but a younger market. Younger people who will be our leaders of tomorrow, and we touched on this as well, they are already into cryptocurrencies. Yes, I'm generalizing, but this is true. They are going to be the leaders of tomorrow, and this is what they like. This is what they want. You know, it's something we have to acknowledge, and we have to come to terms and understand that the current monetary system is going to change. It is going to change either by evolution or revolution. There's nothing in between. It's either going to change by evolution or revolution. An evolution will be a peaceful thing. Evolution. Although if our system changes by revolution, I think it's unlikely it'll be a peaceful thing. And these are our only two alternatives. The system is going to change, and it's going to change either by evolution or revolution. And, you know, being forthright, for that reason, it's a good idea to look at alternative currencies. And this is why I like the cash gold token, which we touched on. And in being transparent here, CGT, the cash gold token, I am somewhat close to the project. I mean, you folks know Gregor Gregersen is the CEO of Cash, and Gregor Gregersen is the founder of Silver Bullion, with where I work. So I am, you know, sort of in lockstep with Cash. I see what's going on with Cash, and I do have a micro share in it. So this is in the interest of transparency here with you guys disclosing it. I know the people who created it because, as mentioned, I work with them. And the good thing, I know the gold with 100% certainty is there when it comes to the Cash token. So there's no different from where I work for Silver Bullion. This is SBTV, Silver Bullion TV. It's the same thing with Cash. Now, the good thing is Cash was built by people who know gold. It wasn't a tech company that came in and said, I have a product to sell you. Let's do this with gold, silver, da, da, da. No, no, no. It was made by gold people who know gold and who know what people who have precious metals want. So it's a huge difference when you look at it from that perspective. So again, just to be transparent with you guys. So let me go on to step 10. Hang on, let me get there. Screen share. Okay, so the black market spreads to commerce as people start to use barter or foreign currency or gold for trade. Okay, and that we haven't got there yet, but you know, that is something that we're going to see. Hasn't happened yet, but we can safely assume when this black or alternative market comes to be, prices of currency, gold, even cryptocurrency, whatever it is trading or seen as money, is going to be either hard to get, and we know what hard to get is when it comes to precious metals, right? Or expensive to get. And we also know what that is when it comes to precious metals. And the black market or alternative market may not be accepting fiat. I mean, you got to imagine at that point, you know, everybody's trying to get out of fiat, and you're over there with your fiat trying to get what people are using as currency or as money. That is going to be incredible. Your $500 is not going to get you anywhere near $500 worth of whatever that currency may be as far as purchasing power. So again, you know, these are things, you know, and I've said this before, have some cash, junk silver, gold, silver, even Bitcoin. You got to acknowledge Bitcoin, and then some type of gold backed currency, which is why I'm thrilled that CGT or that cash gold token has come out. The question is though, how are you going to trade or barter your assets, right? Again, this is why I like CGT. This token makes it possible because the gold is proven. It's already proven to be there. And again, this is the last thing on my list because I could never really find a gold token that would satisfy my own personal needs until CGT came on and when I understood what they were doing with it. Now, the trade-off, I completely get this. The trade-off of if you don't hold it, you don't own it. And I get that. I am one of those guys where I feel more comfortable hanging on to my gold and silver. But can I move it around? If I need to move, can I move it around? And I'm not just talking going to a different county. I'm talking to maybe having to shelter down somewhere very far where I may have to pass border checks or maybe even fly into a different country. Can I bring it with me? And my realistic answer to that was no. You know, I don't know if I'd be able to do it, make it confiscated along the way, make it stolen along the way. And so one of my requirements when it came to the token was I need to be able to have it move or in some ways be borderless. The same way like Bitcoin is, the cash transactions are borderless. When it came to a gold token, I needed my gold to be borderless. And that was why, you know, when cash gold token came along, I'm like, hey, this actually fits one of my requirements. So I had a list of requirements that was already there. And then as this token was being developed, I started to see that, you know, it's ticking off all my requirements, and that's why I like it. And so the thing is, you know, in my opinion, as a precious metals investor, if you hold precious metals, it's an option that you really should look at, because I do get it. If you don't hold it, you don't own it. Completely understand that. I will never argue that debate. But it's just that when it comes to, if I got to move, I run the risk of it being, you know, maybe taken or stolen or something like that. So I would need to have it in either in different places throughout the world, or I would need to have it in a way where it can be almost anywhere in the world. And when I get there, I can get it again. So that was, again, one of my requirements for whenever it came to gold back token. Cash, fiat cash, junk silver, gold, silver, bullion, a crypto like Bitcoin, and then some type of gold back token. Those were my five things that I need to personally have covered. And I don't know what you may feel you need to have personally covered, but those are my five things whenever it comes to something that I can trade or use as a currency. Because again, when the masses start moving, it's going to be way too late. And so you gotta, for me, I try to think ahead and figure out, okay, well, there may not be any one particular thing that works, so I may need to look at a few things that may work. Okay, so anyway, back to steps to inflation. Let me pull up this. Hang on, let me pull it up again. Sorry about that, guys. Okay, so we're on number 11. Government freezes bank accounts because so many people are taking money out of their bank accounts and exchanging it for foreign currency or gold, causing many banks to become in danger of going under. Now, this one hasn't happened yet, but let me go back in the past here. This article is 2002, and it refers to Argentina, where millions of bank accounts are frozen in beleaguered Argentina. Buenos Aires, a few months ago, again, this is back in 2002, Luis Gonzalez was laid off from his job as produce manager at a suburban grocery store here. Like countless other Argentines who have recently joined the ranks of the unemployed, he took his severance pay, about $20,000, and put it in a savings account. And in a short amount of time, he awoke to find that the government was holding his money hostage. Under extraordinary new banking restrictions, he will not be allowed to make any withdrawals until June of 2003. Here's the part. He can't withdraw until June of 2003. This article was written in January of 2002. So this poor guy, for a year and a half, he's not going to have access to his bank account. And, you know, again, this is incredible, because a government will freeze bank accounts when these types of things happen. And again, this is why we talk about having one foot in the system, having one foot out of the system. Because when it happens, it's going to happen, and it's going to happen pretty quick. So this is interesting. For a year and a half, he's not going to be able to have access to his bank account. Amazing. Number 12, wages and prices become indexed to something more stable like a foreign currency or gold. Okay, so this one, another article going back to Argentina. This is just 2019 now. Argentina approves economic measures aimed at ending crisis. Argentina has always had some difficulties here. Let me see if I can find it. Let me see if I can find where it is. I know it. What it talked about was people moving out of Argentina's own currency and trying to get into a different currency. So let me see if I can find that part here where it says in that article. But anyway, that's more or less what it was. Here you go. One of Argentina's main problems is its people prefer to hold dollars rather than pesos, meaning they don't want to hang on to their own currency. They want a different currency. So they try to sell their local currency and often keep the dollars in foreign bank accounts. So in other words, that money is leaving Argentina and people don't want to use it. So wages and prices become indexed to something more stable like a foreign currency or gold. So we see that this is one of the things that happen. And again, you know, you can imagine once the masses move into more of a safe haven or more of a store of wealth, gold, silver, going to be incredibly difficult to get. And for sure, the prices are going to be inflated if you try to get it, even perhaps some cryptocurrencies. 13, wages become paid weekly or even daily. So instead of monthly and the velocity, this will definitely kick in the velocity of money here. Thing is, you know, it hasn't happened yet, but with companies that have had federal contracts, and I worked for them, you were paid every week. At least the ones I was with, we were paid every week. I can tell you, when you're in your 20s and you get paid every week, you get paid every Friday, you will be the biggest contributor to the velocity of money. Get paid on Friday. Spend all your money over the weekend. What are you going to do? You're going to go to a club. You're going to go drinking, whatever it is. You're going to blow that check that you just got on Friday. And then what are you going to do? Go back to work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. You're going to hunker down, just go to work, and that's it. And then you go to get paid on Friday again. Cycle starts all over. That is one way for sure. And so if you combine that with you know, let's say other things like, you know, if you gave some debt forgiveness to student loans, you free up these 20-year-olds. Maybe these 20-year-olds go into these government infrastructure type jobs. Maybe they're getting paid every Friday. You will surely kickstart velocity of money without a doubt. Bad idea, probably, but just saying, if that was something that they really wanted to do, they could easily do it that way. Okay, so moving on, let's go to step number 14. Interest rates become very high. So interest rates, they do become very high. And thing is, go back to Fed Chairman Paul Volcker, whose time was served with Presidents Carter and Reagan. Inflation was spiraling out of control, upward, right? Remember that time, 17-18% or so. I mean, inflation was incredible back then. What did Volcker do? He raised interest rates. Raising interest rates slows down the velocity of money, much the same way lowering interest rates are supposed to spark the velocity of money, get people to spend. And this is, it's a bit of a danger, because if the Fed is desperately trying to get the velocity of money by lowering interest rates and trying to achieve that mythical 2% inflation target, and they can't get it, you know, what makes the Fed think that once inflation gets going, that raising interest rates will stop it? I mean, they've tried a decade, right? Lowering rates, QE, for a decade, they've tried it. They couldn't get the inflation going. So what makes them think, you know, once they start to get it going, that they're going to be able to control it? What's going to happen? A decade of out of control inflation or interest rates rising for a decade? That would be extremely painful, to put it nicely. Thing is, you know, these things happen. Hyperinflation, really, it's just a sneeze away in a sick economy. And like I said, if the Fed can't control it for a decade, you know, trying to get what they want, they can't do it. I, for one, would not trust them that they can control it once it swings around to the other side. So, you know, but what the Fed is doing right now, it's incredibly dangerous. And again, this is the reason why you and me, we have to see these things. It's not conspiracy stuff. It's just staring us all right in the face. We see what's going on. One step in, or one foot in the current monetary system, the one foot in some alternative monetary system. That it's already gotten to a point where that's what we need to do. Okay, so that was step 14, I believe. Step 15, loans are given for much shorter periods of time. And I mean, that one is kind of common sense, because you don't want to loan your friend, loan your friend $100. You tell him, pay me back in, I don't know, give him a couple of years, whatever it is, to pay you back. But in that time, inflation goes up, your purchasing power becomes less, and your friend is going to give you $100. And when you gave your friend $100, you could buy $100 worth of things. When your friend repays you, you can only buy maybe $50 worth of things. So, I mean, this is why loans will become much harder to get, and for much, much, much shorter periods of time. It's kind of the same way that the bonds worked. You don't want to be hanging on to a bond very long. I'll just read through some of these. 16, black market eventually grows larger than the legal market. People no longer worry about a government requirement to use local paper currency. And we saw that at the beginning, one of the first things on Twitter, where they're taking anything, any They're taking anything, basically, alternatives to fiat. Anyway, businesses that follow the law and sell for regulated prices in the local currency cannot buy enough new inventory and soon go out of business, making the percentage of the economy that is in the black market go up further and further. And so, again, this is one reason why you are going to see guys move away, especially if you're a business. You can't stay in fiat when people don't want fiat. And it your purchasing power as a business owner starts to get less and less. And even you as that business owner are going to have to move into a different currency, an alternative currency. That's how the market, the alternative market, starts to grow. People start to no longer accept local paper money. We've seen this time and time again with Argentina, where, you know, if they hang on to their Argentine peso, it starts to lose value day after day, seemingly hour after hour, starts to lose value. They don't want the local currency. They want something else. So this is what we're also going to see. And, you know, in part, I mean, cryptocurrencies are speculation, but in part, you got guys who already see this and who are already making moves to switch over into some type of alternative to the local current monetary system. 18, regular taxes decline because hyperinflation has devastated the economy and much of the economy is now in the black market. Government is losing economic power, and at this step, there is a very real risk of the government failing. And we're kind of sort of getting in this area also. I mean, if you go up and down this list, you know, we've hit so many of the points on this list already. 19, once people get spooked, their willingness to hold money will decline. Velocity of money will expand. This being, again, they know that their $50 today may not be able to buy $50 worth of things tomorrow. So they're going to want to get rid of it as soon as they can. And it is this latter phenomenon that moves a country from very high inflation into hyperinflation. And the interesting thing here is, again, if you get that wealth effect, people have money, they feel comfortable, confident with their job, they're going to go ahead and spend. You are very, very close to that thing also going out of control, where you start to see inflation kick in. So it's a very fine line. The Fed right now is playing an extremely dangerous game, walking a very thin tightrope. Arbitrary definition of hyperinflation might be in excess of 50% per month. That's how they define it. Historically, it generally has taken 2 to 3 years before growth in the money supply has translated into a meaningful acceleration of inflation. 2 to 3 years before growth in the money supply has translated into a meaningful acceleration in inflation. Well, we're seeing that money supply growing crazy right now. So are we going to see it in 2 to 3 years, that inflation? Could be, if we're understanding this right. The timing of the onset of full-blown hyperinflation likely will be coincident with a broad global repudiation of the U.S. dollar. We're kind of seeing this already. I mean, we've been over where people are trying to get off of the U.S. dollar. They're trying to get away from that U.S. dollar. The situation will quickly evolve from a deepening depression into an intensifying hyperinflationary Great Depression. And, well, we kind of know the story here. While the resulting U.S. economic difficulties will have broad global impact, the initial hyperinflation should be largely a U.S. problem, albeit with major implications for the global currency system. So this is everyone. It's not just the U.S. dollar. This is every currency, being that the dollar is the reserve currency. Number 20, bottom line. Bottom line, the larger the amount of outstanding debt is, the larger will be the potential increase in the money supply. The more the money supply grows, the more likely it is that there will be hyperinflation and the potential breakdown in the money, the more the money supply grows, the more likely it is that there will be hyperinflation and a potential breakdown of money demand, the unfolding of the crack up boom. Bottom line, isn't this what we're doing already? Now under the cover of the bug, we're already seeing this. Alex Miles, thank you. Appreciate it. When metals go to the moon in a hyperinflation environment, you will not be able to cash out because cash will be a liability. Only a barter will work. Alex, Excellent point. Again, thank you. Thank you for the super chat. Excellent point. Because the thing is, we hear all the time, you know, guys are asking, well, how do you exit? How do you exit? You know, if you're holding all this gold and silver, how do you exit? Well, the thing is, you will not want to exit back into fiat. That is, take that off the list. You're not going to exit into fiat. You're going to exit into someone having, you know, a bit of, I don't know if bad luck's the right word. You're going to run into someone who's having financial difficulty and has to sell a business. And he sees he can't sell his business for fiat. He's going to see that people are now using, let's say, gold, silver. I need to get gold and silver. I can't get gold and silver. Well, you have gold and silver. So you may be able to move into his business, buy his business with your gold and silver. That's what you exit into. Somebody may have to sell their home, their apartment, their condo. They're not going to sell it for fiat. They're going to want to sell it for whatever is the currency being used, which may be gold, silver. You are going to exit some of that gold and silver into a person's home, a person's condo. You're going to buy that condo, that home. You're going to exit into different things. And there's going to be a lot, because people who are not doing what you're doing right now, they're not. You got to imagine the economy is going to be really bad. You're going to see prices falling, business prices falling, home prices falling. A lot of these things are going to be falling because guys are going to need to have whatever that currency is. And, you know, they're not going to want to go back into fiat. They're going to, if they know you can buy it for gold or silver, and they know gold and silver is the store of wealth, the store of value, they're going to want that gold and silver instead. These are all your exit points. Exit point is not necessarily going back into fiat. That's not the, it's not the exit point. So, I mean, Alex, it's a great question. You know, it's something that we see all the time. You know, what's your exit strategy? What are you supposed to do? You know, if people aren't taking money, well, if you're hanging on to gold and silver and you see the value of your gold and silver going up relative to dollars, you're going to see another side of it where you're going to see your gold and silver being priced at real items, real commodities, real things of value, whether, like I say, a house, a business, whatever it is. So the fiat side, you probably won't be exiting into fiat. You're going to be exiting into real things. And that's the wealth transfer. That's the wealth transfer, where gold and silver is going to allow you to have wealth transferred to you, because you have what people are going to be looking at, a store of value. So again, it's not just about the price. It's about these things, inflation, hyperinflation. It's about things like that. Again, it's just more than price. And I know a lot of you guys understand that. And a lot of people are on the fence, you know, they're trying to understand, hey, but gold, silver, it's a bad investment, you know, since 2011, it's only gone down, this, that. In price, it's gone down. But as a store of wealth, a store of value, I think day by day, it's making a stronger case, you know, especially with what the Fed is doing now. So don't get hooked on the price. What you really want to be looking at is its ability to store value and preserve wealth, because wealth is going to transfer. And if you have that commodity or that currency or whatever people see as money, that store of value, if you have it, you are going to be able to have some things transferred to you that maybe you ordinarily wouldn't have been able to get. So again, this is why you want to have gold and silver. So let me take a look at some of these questions here, and then I'll close up with commentary. Elbow Sanchez, best thing I ever did was get out of the system. I tell you what, my friend, I feel exactly the same. I move as far away from the system as I reasonably can. And I'll be honest, I feel good about it. I don't have any reservation about it. I do sleep better. Some people, you know, like to say you'll sleep better at night when you have some gold and silver. It's all true. You know, you look at the price, you know, yeah, again, sometimes you feel like, well, okay, did I do the right thing or not? But then you look at other things. You look at what's going on around you. And you realize, well, I'm definitely doing the right thing. You know, it's just time. It's just the timing. And I'm all for, you know, the longer it takes, maybe the better. It gives all of us a chance to accumulate as much as we can, as much as we possibly can anyway, whatever we're comfortable with. And, you know, it's nice to know that you have that insurance, so to speak. And so I'll just move into to the commentary part here. We know all we need to know, and the rest is just timing. You know, fiat system printing is debasing. Central banks are debasing, and they are trying to get you and me to spend our debased money, velocity of money. I'm convinced we are going to see a wealth effect in this time, you know, whether it's infrastructure projects or the Fed holding the markets up to give traders and the feeling of invincibility. Their goal is to get you and me to spend to kickstart the velocity of money. The mother of manipulations is happening right now, and this cannot, will not last. What the Fed and central banks around the world are doing right now, it's beyond sinister, guys. And I mean, a lot of people, you're hearing that word more and more. It's beyond sinister, and we need to opt out. We have to find a way to opt out. We need to have an option to move away from this fiat system, but more importantly, to clearly see where this wealth effect, this market manipulation by central banks is leading us to. And that is a bit of a danger point, because the wealth effect, people are going to feel confident. And I'm all for that. I mean, I'm all for people feeling confident with their job, their work, their situations, whatever it is, financial situation. I'm all for that, you know, having people feel good. But we got to also see clearly through it all. And opting out before that printing press overheats and breaks down is critical. Imagine this. What if the Fed's printing press broke? What if it already broke and we couldn't support the markets the way that we're doing now? Or the Fed can't support it the way it's supporting it now? Let's say that printing press broke. Where would we be? Where would we be right now if that printing press was broke? Or I'm starting to hear more and more guys saying, you know, we're going to see everything fall apart with that printing press actually running 24/7. It's not going to matter. It's even going to fall apart with that thing going full steam ahead. Where would we be? So, I mean, once you grasp that thought, go ahead and ask yourself, just reason out a little bit. If that printing press, you know, doesn't even have to break for these things to happen, you know, it's only confidence in the monetary system that is keeping this thing glued together. And if our confidence breaks, the whole monetary system is going to break. And we are, it's just a matter of psyche. It's just a matter of the way we think right now that is holding things together. And that's why we opt out. We opt out into things like gold and silver. I mean, when hyperinflation starts to rattle, even just inflation, when that starts to rattle, which from the list we just went over today, and we're easily more than halfway, halfway with that list, we could easily tick off these boxes there. Gold and silver is going to preserve your wealth. And while the inflating dollar is going to destroy your wealth, it's important to understand. So simply put, I'll put it this way. Do you have life insurance? Yes. Fire insurance? Yes. Auto insurance? Yes. Health insurance? Yes. Home insurance? Yes. So let me ask you, do you have money insurance? Some of you guys right now are scratching your head or thinking, what the heck is this guy talking about? Money insurance? What's probably one of the most important insurances you could have, probably is. So, you know, it's an odd thing to hear, money insurance. But what do you have as money insurance? You have your health, your home, your fire, your auto, all of these insurances. But what insurance do you have for money insurance? I mean, you ever thought about that? I know a number of us have, and I know maybe for some of you, it's something entirely new. The answer is gold and silver. Gold and silver is money insurance. And again, it's more than just price. This is why we go ahead and pick up things like gold and silver. Okay. Michael B, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Yeah, I would appreciate the like buttons as well. Would appreciate even more if you could help people on the fence who are trying to understand, why do we like gold and silver? What is it? What's the reason why people buy gold and silver? It's just a shiny yellow rock or whatever it is. Why do people like it? through your comments, daily conversations, just try and help people to understand that just a bit. You know, it's not about the price. I mean, are there better investments than gold and silver? Of course. If I said no, I'd be lying to you. Of course there are better investments that could make you more money, get you more yield, whatever it is. But is there a better insurance? I don't think so. You know, is there a better store of wealth, store of value? I don't think so. And these are the things that the other components that we need to look at. You know, it's not just the price. And I know a lot of you folks know that, but there are people who are trying to understand, why should I buy it? Maybe I should just buy the ETF. Well, you want to be able to actually hold something. And some of you guys might be saying, but you just talked about a token. Well, it's a token that can be converted either into cash. You can exchange it on a cryptocurrency, or you can redeem it for physical gold and silver. And like I said, it's, in a way, it's almost like it's borderless. I mean, you could have a token, and then when you, let's say you fly over to Singapore, and you can tell them, I want the gold, and you can get the gold in Singapore. Or if you're in the States, you know, you have the token and maybe you want to trade with it, you can trade with it, or maybe you want to redeem it. Well, Dylan Gage is one of the companies involved with Cash. I'm not sure exactly what to label them as a part owner, perhaps a partner, one of those terms. I'm not sure the definite term, but they are involved. So let's say you're in the States. Well, your gold is not crossing any international border at that point. It's already in the US. So again, you can easily take delivery. So that's one of the other things that, you know, it's very flexible in a lot of ways. But again, you know, physical, I'm never going to argue that point. I mean, even I have physical with me. I mean, it's comforting to say the least, but you know, there are things that you got to be able to do with it. And so again, it just all depends on how you see things. Let me get back to some of your comments here. But again, try and help people to understand it's more than just the price, the reason why people do buy gold and silver. Pudenda Johnson, gold makes me happy. Actually, it does, doesn't it? I mean, you walk away from the shop, you know, with your tube of silver or this one nice coin you were waiting to get, and you go home and, you know, it does make you happy. And I mean, I remember a long time ago, I picked up one silver eagle, one silver maple. That was it. Got on the train, the MRT, sat in the train, and this strange thought entered my mind where, you know, if things go bad, I might just be the richest person on this train right now because I have real money. I have sound money. And it's strange because even just that little bit, just that one coin, you realize what you've done. You know, you realize that the position, the better position that you put yourself in. And totally agree. It does make you smile. And this is what it's about. You need to be able to opt out in some ways of the system. So good comment. Fat Vegan, good luck getting that delivery on gold ETF. That is true. I mean, we see it time and time and time again. I mean, there's more ETFs than actual physical gold. So, you know, exactly. Good luck in trying to get your gold if you get that ETF. ETF, you can make money on it, but you're kind of missing the point as far as being able to acquire physical at some point. So there you go. So a few more comments and then I'll head out. Don't want to bore you guys. Don't want to bore you guys too much. Let's see. Mockingbird, 9,000. Richest person in my neighborhood. No one else. No one else got nothing. Yeah, see, that's the thing. You know, we talk about being a blessing, not a burden. It's going to be a lot of burdens out there. And so as much as possible, we have to try and be that blessing, either by having it for our family and maybe some of our friends, or by at least trying to expose people to understanding what it's about. So you know, another great comment out there. So maybe I'll take a look at one more comment and then be heading out. Let you guys get to sleep wherever you might be. G-Man Dallas just loaded up on silver. Kind of makes you feel good, huh? I mean, I'm always happy to see guys who understand it. And again, I do work for a silver and gold company, a precious metals company. And it makes me happy when I see stuff like this. And even if you didn't buy it from us, I mean, at least I know you're doing the things you need to do to protect and provide. And those are extremely important. And hopefully you can spread the word. And if enough people understand it, then, you know, we can have a lot more blessings than burdens out there. So good point. Most important thing is, you know, I mean, if you get it from us, great. But if not, just get it, you know, get some gold, get some silver. You're gonna feel better. So good comment there. So with that, you know, I'm going to need to be stepping out, let you guys get going with your evenings or your day. I appreciate you folks being here. Comments are appreciated. Most of them, most of the comments anyway. Christopher Mulan coming up on Thursday. I think we'll have a pretty good talk. So until then, I'll see you guys next week. As always, saddle up for what's coming ahead and silver up as well. I'll see you guys next week. Take care.